Good morning. What a wonderful day it is to be with everybody this morning. I hope everybody's had a good week this past week. There are still some we need to remember in our prayers. There are some that are traveling and some are not well. And let's keep them in our prayers. I'd also like to remind everybody there's a sign-up sheet back here on the table. If you're interested in an evangelism class, we're going to start in two Tuesdays. The first is September the 6th, and I would to sign up so we'll know just how many to plan for and get ready to learn about those things. When you think about heaven, what is it that you think about? What is it that floods your mind? Is it those pearly streets and those pearly gates? Is it those streets of gold? Is it the angels in heaven? Is it being able to worship God face to face? Would it be that maybe you want to get to heaven so you can meet someone again who's went on ahead of you? Maybe it's somebody in Scripture you've read about and you really want to sit down and just ask them what life was like. What would it have been like to walk in their shoes just a little while? When we think about heaven, there's a lot of things that may flood our mind. And when we think about those ideas, the things that we talk about when we talk about heaven or the picture that we get is it's just a little bit different for everyone. And what I mean by that is some of us really want to say, look at Jesus and say thank you and just over and over. And some of us want to look up people like Peter and say, how in the world could you deny Jesus? And so when we think about the idea, I want to know just, get in your mind, how much do you want to go there? How much do you desire to be where God is? To be in your eternal heavenly home? How much do you desire to do that? What does that mean to you when I say one day you're going to go to a heavenly home? What does that mean for you? And there are some people who are good, wonderful, faithful people who worry. That worry by some chance that they are just not good enough. They're going to miss out on heaven all along. And what I want us to do this morning is take a few minutes to answer the question, am I going to heaven? Am I going to heaven? And so when we look at this, I want to ask the question, are you prepared? And as you think about that question, are you prepared, start turning your Bibles to Matthew chapters 24 and 25. And as we turn here, what we find is at the beginning of chapter 24, the apostles are really looking at these wonderful buildings. Buildings that Jesus, just at the end of 23, was crying over as he looked over from the mountaintop, seeing this great city and saying, Jerusalem, Jerusalem, how I wanted to gather you like a hen who gathers her chicks, but you would not. I mean, if you've ever watched chicks and chickens, I mean, they like to kind of keep everybody together. And the picture is Jesus wanted to keep his people together, but they didn't always want to be together. And they didn't always want to follow God. And you have this question in this conversation where the apostles ask, when will these things be? And tell us the sign of your coming. And what Jesus does, he answers a couple of more questions. See, in their mind, the temple could not have ever been destroyed unless the end of time comes. But Jesus separates that. He spends half the time in chapter 24 talking about this destruction of Jerusalem and what's going to happen, and he gives a lot of attention to it, and then his focus changes. He starts talking about this end time, these last days, and notice how he starts this out in Matthew 24, starting in verse 36. He says, but of that day and hour, no one knows, not even the angels of heaven, but my Father only. But as the days of Noah were, so also will be the coming of the Son of Man be. For as in the days before the flood, they were eating and drinking, marrying and giving a marriage until the day that Noah entered the ark, and did not know until the flood came and took them all away. So also will the coming of man be. Just imagine, if you will, what that day was like. Here we have Noah, and he's been building this ark. And as we look at 1 Peter and 2 Peter, we see Noah being called a preacher and how he's telling people what's going to happen as he's building this ark. And he's telling people that this flood is going to come and the world's going to be destroyed. And then one day, he gets in the ark And God shuts them in. And you start looking at just that picture. What was life like for everybody else as Noah was building the ark and as Noah was putting the animals in it, as Noah was covering it with the tar, the pitch. And just think about what life was like for everybody else. They were eating and drinking, marrying and giving in marriage. Life for them was just going on like normal, but the whole time Noah is preparing for this great big flood that's going to happen. Could you imagine what those people thought when it started to rain? Now think about it. Life is as it always is, normalized. And then Noah and his family shut up in the ark. You say, what are you talking about? See, it works this way. Often we read Scripture and the way Jesus describes it, the way Peter describes it, is this idea of he's going to come back as a thief in the night. And the idea with a thief is you don't know when the thief is coming, because if you knew, you would be prepared. So in order to be prepared for the thief, you just always need to be prepared. So what Jesus says, this is what life's going to look like when he comes back. People are going to eat and drink. Now, I understand. Hear it about the final amen. We're going to go eat, right? I don't want to give a time. But the idea is we're going to go eat. We're going to get up, we're going to love each other, say, I'm glad that you are here, good seeing you, and we're going to go somewhere and we're going to eat. And if you eat, there's something that generally comes along. Like, we got to get some water or some sweet tea or something to wash it down. It tastes good, but you don't need to stick with us, you know, the whole meal. We need to continue on. Today we're going to be eating and drinking. Now, I don't know of anybody today being married, not here at the congregation, but would it be out of the ordinary to think that somebody somewhere in this earth of ours is going to get married? Do you think that'll happen tomorrow? Do you think it might happen on Tuesday or Wednesday? And I hope we're just not eating and drinking only on Sunday, or, well, we'd be miserable and I wouldn't be able to maintain my shape. And when you think about it, it's any day. Life is just going to go on as normal. And we got to prepare, because we don't know exactly when that day is going to be when Jesus comes back. See, as surprised as those people was when it rained, I imagine they're going to be equally surprised when we see Jesus come back. They're not looking for him. He's just going to come back. When? I don't know. But we got to be prepared. See, that's what Jesus goes on to talk about in verse 43. He says, But know this, that if the master of the house had known what hour the thief would come, he would have watched and not allowed his house to be broken into. Therefore you also be ready, for the Son of Man is coming at an hour you do not expect. And so then we go into chapter 25, and what we have are three parables. Three parables describing these things to give out the information so they can grasp hold of it. And the first parable he gives is about a wedding ceremony. Now, when we think about that, it's totally different today than it was in Jesus' day. I mean, today you literally can marry someone, and you can meet someone and be married to someone on the same day. You could do that. You can meet someone and say, I want to get married. Well, I do too. I think it's going to last forever. So let's go get married. You get a marriage license. It's really that easy. You can do that. But in Jesus' day, it wasn't like that. There was this long period of time. See, what would happen is this man would give this woman, the betrothed, a sign, a symbol. And I'm going to come back and get you. When you coming? Well, I got to build a room on my daddy's house. So however long that takes. I got to save up enough money to live a whole year. Because according to law, I can't work. A whole year, we got to get to know each other. Now all of a sudden you're like, this ain't happening today and tomorrow. You don't know when it's going to happen. And so, but there's this promise. When time is right, I'm going to come and get you. See, it's that context we see in chapter 25, starting verse 1, we see the, the 10 wise and 10 foolish virgins. The idea was they're invited to be part of this wedding feast. That's what's going to happen. But the bridegroom tarries in his coming. He doesn't come exactly when he says he's going to. He's delayed, in other words. And they all knew that they're part of this great big event. And five of them prepared for the event, and five of them were not prepared. They were halfway prepared. They didn't have enough. So they asked those who were prepared to spare some of the oil. You remember how it goes. The wise virgins, what they tell the foolish? Well, if we give you some of ours, then we won't have enough and you won't have enough. Go to those who buy and sell and get you some. Go get prepared. They knew the time was coming. They were not prepared. And at the time the foolish virgins come back, the ones that were wise and prepared, they were sealed up in the house. The other five come back. Can you see them locking? And here's the bridegroom. Now, why did they know to wait on the bridegroom? Because he said he was coming. And we have this, let us in. Notice what he says. It's in verse 11. Afterward, the other virgins came also, saying, Lord, Lord, open to us. But he answered and said, Assuredly, I say to you, I do not know you. I don't know you. But we're part of this wedding procession. I know. I don't know you. The people I told would be ready. Notice he goes on to say, Watch therefore, for you neither know the day nor the hour in which the Son of Man is coming. So that's really something to think about. Are you prepared? You know, there's only one person in this room outside of God. I mean, we could say God knows. But there's only one person outside of God that knows if you're ready. And it's you. You're the only one that can answer the question. So let's ask two more questions. We have, are you prepared? You're the only one that can answer that. I don't know. But you know. Are you washed in the blood? Are you washed in the blood? See, when we look at Jesus, what he says in Mark chapter 10, see, here we have the disciples, and they're arguing amongst one another. Who's going to be the greatest in the kingdom of heaven? Who is it? I mean, you can almost hear them. Peter saying, I am. James and John. Maybe Philip's in there. Maybe Thomas is in the mix. Who's the greatest? Well, of course I'm the greatest. They're in this discussion. And they don't really want to tell. Jesus asked, what are you discussing on the road? He really doesn't want to tell them and they don't want to tell him what they were discussing. All it was is he tells them this. In verse 42, you know that those who are considered rulers over the Gentiles lord over them, and their great ones exercise authority over them. Yet it shall not be so among you, but whoever desires to become great among you shall be your servant. And whoever of you desires to be first shall be slave of all. And the idea, to be great, you got to really serve others. I mean, it's this set, you know, bringing yourself down some to be great. But notice the example he gave. For even the Son of Man did not come to be served, but to serve. Now notice, you look at Jesus. You look at Jesus and say, what kind of life did Jesus live? The Son of God. Served all kinds of people. The touchable, the untouchable, people like those people liked, those people didn't like. See, Jesus served all kinds of people, but notice how he goes further to say, this is how far I'm going to serve. To give his life a ransom for many. To give his life a ransom for many. See, the way Paul would describe this in Romans chapter 6 and verse 23, if you'd like to turn over to Romans 6, we'll be right there. He says, the wages of sin is death. Now think about it, and just in your mind, get the picture. You told a lie when you were in middle school. Now I can say that. I imagine many of us had said something about our homework in middle school. Why don't you have the paper done? I didn't have time. Well, what did you do all evening? I don't want to tell the truth. I don't know. That's a lie. But when we sit down and look at it, the wages of sin is death. Every time that we've done things that God says not to do and did not do what God said do. See, that's sin. Those who know to do good and do not do it, to him it is sin. If you know to do the right thing and you don't do it, that's sin. If you know this is the right thing and you do the wrong thing, also sin, James 4:12. So when we look here in Romans 6, for the wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life in Christ Jesus our Lord. Every time that we have sinned, Jesus' blood can cover it. Every single time. But we got to be what? We got to be washing the blood. If we're not washing the blood, then we cannot have that forgiveness of sin. Because that's where the forgiveness is. Notice if you go back up, Romans chapter 6, starting in verse 1. Notice how Paul lays it out. What shall we say then? Shall we continue in sin that grace may abound? Certainly not. How shall we who died to sin live any longer in it? Or do you not know that as many of us as were baptized into Christ Jesus, were baptized into his death? His death? That's where he shed his blood. You remember, it was after he died when the soldier reached a spear up and thrust it into his side. And what flowed out? The blood and water flowed out. It was in his death the blood was shed. Notice, as many of you as were baptized into Christ, were baptized into his death, therefore were buried with him through baptism into death, that just as Christ was raised from the dead by the glory of the Father, even so we also should walk in newness of life. For if we have been united together in the likeness of his death, certainly we shall also be in the likeness of his resurrection. Knowing this, that our old man was crucified with him, that the body of sin might be done away with, that we should no longer be slaves of sin, for he who has died has been freed from sin. Now notice, how did Paul say that you died to sin? It's in your baptism. See, that's how you come in contact with that blood. So the big question you have to ask is, again, are you washed in the blood? Did that blood take away all those sins? Are you white as snow? Did you do those things? But there's a second question. See, when we look at the first question, have you had your sins washed away? You say, I've been baptized, or I haven't been baptized. I've done what God says to do. I've obeyed from the heart that former doctrine I taught. That's what Paul referenced in Romans chapter 6, is that they changed who they follow. They don't follow sin. They follow righteousness. They follow God now. They follow Jesus. See, their life has changed. At that point in time, they come in contact with the blood of Jesus. But there's a second question. So I wish the first one was the one we had to ask. There's a second. Are you living right? Are you living right? See, that one's a little harder to look at, isn't it? See, we could say, yes, I've been baptized and come in contact with the blood of Christ. But if we're done that and we're not living right, then there's another thing we've got to look at. See, that is the thing about the Christian life. The Christian life is living. It's living. It's not stationary. It's living. See, when we look in 1 John chapter 1, in 1 John chapter 1, starting in verse 7, notice how John declares this. Talks about those who say they have fellowship with God but walk in darkness. Let's go and read that. 1 John chapter 1 and verse 6, he says, If we have fellowship with him and walk in darkness, we lie and do not practice the truth. And now if we say we have things in common with God, but we don't live it. If it's darkness, if we're living the ways of the world, we're living the ways of sin, we're living the ways of Satan, we're not living the way God would live, we're not living the way Jesus would live, if we're not living for Christ in our lives daily, if we're not living for him, we're lying. We don't have fellowship with God. Why? It's really hard to have fellowship with someone you're not paying attention to. You can't do it. You can't have things in common with somebody you're not paying attention to. Practice the truth. We don't practice the truth if we walk in darkness. But there's a but, there's the other side of that. But if we walk in the light as He is in the light, we have fellowship with one another, and the blood of Jesus Christ, His Son, cleanses us from all sins. Some things to look at. We have this idea of walking in the light, and the idea here is really living. Living in the light. If we live the way God teaches, if we live by God's Word, if His words is a lamp unto our feet and a light to our path, if we truly, as Psalm 119:105, if we really want to live for God, if we really put it into practice, if we really try to live that truth, then we have fellowship with God. We have things in common. We're walking together. Have you ever been in a three-legged race? Now, I know it's funny to watch people in it, right? If they don't know what they're doing, and they may not even like each other, but they get, for some reason, thought somebody at a family reunion thought it'd be a good idea to tie your legs together. And so now you got one, your outside leg is free, your inside leg is attached to somebody you may have had a falling out over dinner with. But somebody thought it was a good idea to tie you guys up. You know why? They knew it'd be funny. And right when they said go, what happens? You take two steps and you're all on your face. Why? Because this one's wanting to go this way, this one's wanting to go that way. There's no communication, there's no talking, and we ain't getting anywhere. Until you find out how to get up. How do you get up if you're tied to someone and you're both on your face? You got to overcome some difficulty you have, put that behind you, and you got to work together. See, if we say that we have fellowship with God, if we are yoked up with Jesus, if we are connected, and we're not living the way God wants us to, we're going to end up on our face every single time. But if we practice the life that God says live, then we can run with Him. We can run with Him. Why? Because we're working the same game plan. And the blood of Jesus Christ cleanses you from all sin. That is a continual cleansing. It's in the present tense, which means you're cleansed now, you'll be cleansed later, you'll be cleansed tomorrow, a month, a year, 10 years, it doesn't matter. If you're walking with Him, you're cleansed. But you got to be in the blood first. You got to be washed. If you're not washed, you're not even yoked up. But once you're washed, you got to be yoked up, tied together, work with. Live it. Notice, if we say we have no sin, we deceive ourselves, and the truth is not in us. Does that mean you'll be perfect? No. But it doesn't mean you can't try. It doesn't mean you can't live. It doesn't mean you give up. It means you keep on. If we confess our sins, He is faithful and just to forgive us our sins and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. The idea if we keep telling Him, and the idea of confess means that we say the same things. If I keep doing this, I'm going to be lost. I need your help. I need your mercy. I need your grace. I have to rely on you. See, that's putting all of our hope and trust in who? In Jesus. Not in us. We live. We strive to live. We put into practice what is taught. If we're going to get there, it's still on Jesus' blood. That's it. That's the only way we get there. But we got to be living accordingly. Got to live it. Have you ever got somewhere you wanted to get by accident? You want to get somewhere. And you know where this is. You get there by accident. Do you think people get living debt-free by accident? Have you ever thought about that? How much planning does it take to live debt-free? How much execution does it take to live debt-free? How much sacrifice does it take to do that? How about living for Jesus? How about living for Jesus? See, that's something really to think about. It's all worth it. It's all profitable. We've got to ask the question, are we living right? Are you living right? Notice the way Paul talked about it in Romans chapter 8. We're going to link two verses together real quick. Romans chapter 8 and verse 29. It comes right after verse 28. Verse 28 says, "And we know that all things work together for good to those who love God and to those who are called according to His purpose." That probably is the most recognizable verse in the whole thing. And the idea that working toward our good isn't that all things are good. It's that the things that are happening to us happen to us to do something for us. It works toward our good and our salvation. Well, how do you know? Look, notice verse 29. "For whom He foreknew, He also predestined to be conformed to the image of His Son, that He might be the firstborn among many brethren." Now, I did look at it. Conformed to the image of His Son. The things that we go through, we have two ways of looking at it. We can either look to God to get us out of it and get us through it and put our trust in Him, or we can turn our back and say, "God, I don't know why You did this to me. You know I couldn't handle that." We can either blame God or look for God to get us through it. There's only two answers. But if we trust in God and live through those things, who do we become more like? We become more like Jesus. Have you ever sat and thought about all the things Jesus went through so He could pay that ransom for our sins? Have you thought about that? He went through all of that so we can make it. The things that we go through is to help us look more like Him. Notice Galatians chapter 2 and verse 20. Notice Paul brings the chapter 2 to a close before he switches over a little bit in chapter 3. And the idea here is that living for Christ, not away from the law, not being hypocritical with our faith, but really trusting in Jesus. Notice how he puts it. "I have been crucified with Christ. It is no longer I who live, but Christ lives in me. In the life which I now live in the flesh, I live by faith in the Son of God who loved me and gave Himself for me." Now notice that. Paul's saying, "I want to be so empty of myself that people see Christ living in me. I want to empty the things that keeps me from being who God wants me to be, or what keeps me from honoring Christ the way I need to. I want to be like Jesus so He can be honored." When people see me, they don't really see me. They see Jesus. See, that's the living right part. I've heard it said, you may have even said it. "I don't know why somebody's calling me at this hour. They know I was going to be at church." And that's how it's said. We know it's church services. "I don't know why they're calling me here. They know where I'm going to be. They know I'm not going to answer that." Well, how'd they know that? Because your manner of life should have told them that. They don't always listen to it, but it should have told them. There's certain things that we uphold with our life, or certain things that we condemn with our life. The thing with living right is we're practicing what Jesus taught. That there's a saying. And saying, it looks sounds like this is when you think about the saying. If someone claims to be something, they need to be that. I don't know if you ever heard that or not, but that's something I grew up hearing and saying. If somebody claims it, then that's what they need to be. I mean, it's like this. Say someone claims to be a carpenter, and they're supposed to come and put in a screened-in porch on your house. But you look at it, and you say, "This isn't right at all. I mean, there's big gaping holes coming through." They kind of cobbled a little bit. They did a little bit of carpentry, but if you have a screened-in back porch and you got 3-inch holes down the side of it, did they really screen you in a porch? Did they do what they said they did? Did they take all that into account? But you paid them. Would you be happy with the result? Well, no. If they claim it, they need to be that. If they claim to be the best, they need to be the best. If we claim to be a Christian, then we need to be that. The proof is in the pudding. I know we've heard that, right? The proof's in the pudding. Take the measuring stick out, poke it into your life, pull it out, and what does it say? Brother Ken made mention earlier that Jesus spiritually is with us when we take the Lord's Supper. You know the reality of that, right? He's with us when we leave this building. He's with us when we go eat. He's with us when we go to Walmart, even at Walmart, something to remember. He's with us when we're on our social media pages. Definitely got to remember, right? He's with us everywhere. What if we put that measuring stick in, the little dipstick, and pulled it out? What would it look like? You know, you already know the answer to that question. See, the thing is, am I going to heaven? 1 John chapter 5, verse 13. That you may know you have eternal life and continue to believe in the name of the Son of God. See, he doesn't want us to be a not knowing type of people. That's not it. It's not like we're going to wake up our eyes and say, ah, I found it out. People don't accidentally miss heaven and people don't accidentally get there. Heaven is a prepared place for a prepared people. So we got two questions. Are you washed in the blood? Have you put him on in baptism? Had those sins washed away? Have you done that? If not, why not? What is keeping you from it? Question two, are you living like it? Are you living right? Are you living like you obeyed the gospel? Or are you not? I can't answer those questions for you. But you know the answer. Today, are you going to heaven? If not, why not? Is there any way we can help you today? If you need our help, you can come forward as we sing the song of invitation.